You're listening to American Timelines.
American Timelines.
American Timelines.
By History for Jerks.
By History for Jerks.
By History for Jerks.
It's the greatest podcast ever.
American Timelines is a member of the Queen City Podcast Network, powered by Ortho Carolina. Find out more at queencitypodcastnetwork.com.
History for Jerks.
Welcome to another episode of American Timelines. I'm Amy.
And I'm Helen Dorothy Martin, an American actress of stage and television, best known for my roles as Wanda on the CBS sitcom Good Times and as Pearl Shay on the NBC sitcom 227.
I remember her.
I was born in St. Louis, Missouri.
I remember Pearl.
Yep, I was born in 1909.
She was awesome.
Yep, I went to Fisk University.
All right, that's Joe. And this is the podcast that brings you all the crazy, nostalgic, interesting events from the past.
I was in a movie with Kim Fields.
And today we are going to discuss 1964.
1964, that's right. We left off, if you remember, at the first ever New York City Comic Convention.
That's right.
Where all the panelists died.
No, that's not right.
In freaky accidents or of old age or aneurysms
later in life.
And that brings us to, we're going to start off in August.
Okay. We August got a lot 1st, to cover, so we got to go
we
quick.
We do. I don't have a lot. August 1st, 1964.
Yes.
Was a Saturday.
Okay.
Japan's Hiroshima peace flame has been burning continuously since it was lit on this day.
Okay.
And it will remain lit until all nuclear bombs on the planet are destroyed and the planet is free from the threat of nuclear annihilation.
So when did... this is a dumb question.
Saturday, August 1st, 1964 is when they lit it.
So it was a 20-year anniversary kind of deal, maybe.
64. So no, it was like 19 years, but it was close to around the same time. I don't think it's anything to do with when it was, but the Flame of Peace was designed by Kenzo Tange, professor of the University of Tokyo, 1964, and there's like a pedestal. Mm-hmm. You can see it online. It's like there's, it's a shape of hands pressed together at the wrist and bent back so that the palms open up towards the sky. The design is to console the souls of victims who craved water and wished for nuclear abolition and everlasting world peace.
Yep.
So
sad.
Yep. In 1994, the flame was used to light the sacred fire for the Asian Games held in Hiroshima City. Mm. And that same day that was lit, we have a new number one song on the Billboard charts by the Beatles again.
All right.
Are you ready to hear it?
I'm ready. Too loud.
It's been a hard day's night, and I've been working like a dog. It's been a hard day's night. I should be sleeping like a log. But when I get hold of you, I find the things that you do make me feel.
I was going home in the car, and Dick Lester suggested the title A Hard Day's Night from something Ringo said. I had used it in his own right, but it was an off-the-cuff remark by Ringo. You know, one of those meta-proisms, a Ringoism where he said it not to be funny, just said it. So Dick Lester said, we're going to use that title, and the next morning I brought it in the song because there was a specific little competition between Paul and I as to who got the A-side and who got the hit singles. That was John Lennon, quoted 1980.
Okay, so they got the title before they wrote the lyrics?
Yeah, they had the title that they wanted to do.
I see.
And then he brought that song in. The genesis of the song was later recalled by Evening Standard journalist Maureen Cleave, who was a friend of the Beatles. One day, I picked up John in a taxi and took him to Abbey Road for a recording session. The tune to the song, A Hard Day's Night, was in his head. The words scrawled on a birthday card from a fan to his little son Julian. When I get home to you, it said, I find my tiredness is through. Rather a feeble line about tiredness, I said. Okay, he said.
Will you stop doing cheerfully. That voice, please?
Well, this is her voice. And borrowing my pen, instantly changed it to the slightly suggestive, when I get home to you, I find the things that you do will make me feel all right. The other Beatles were in the studio, and of course, the wonderful George Martin. John sort of hummed the tune to the others. They had no copies of the words or anything else, and 3 hours later, I was none the wiser about how they'd done it, but the record was made. And you can see the birthday card in the British Library.
Okay.
Maureen Cleave. That's exactly how she sounded.
I don't think she
It's a spot-on impression. Rich no, Little couldn't even do it better.
I'm going to do nay on that one.
You don't know. And then August 15, 1964, the Beatles are knocked violently off the charts by a little-known man named Dean Martin.
Yeah. Dean Martin, huh?
Yeah. Although this song was written 20 years earlier.
This song hit the yeah. Everybody Loves Somebody
Recorded by everybody else. But
it's so funny. The Beatles music in this is so different. This,
yeah. Although still a major recording artist, Martin had not had a top 40 hit since 1958.
Oh.
With the British invasion ruling the U.S. charts, few had hopes that an Italian crooner would have had been singing mainly standards for almost 20 years would sway many teenagers. And Martin resented rock and roll. And his attitude created conflict at home with his 14-year-old son, Dean Paul Martin, who, like many teenagers at the time, worshipped pop groups like the Beatles. He told his son, I'm going to knock your pallies off the charts. And on August 15, 1964, he did just that. Everybody Loves Somebody knocked the Beatles A Hard Day's Night off the number one slot on the Billboard charts, going straight up to the top of both the Billboard Hot 100 and the Pop Standard Singles chart, the latter for 8 weeks.
Awesome.
And then we're going to just jump right to the next song on August 22nd.
It's a hit parade here.
Yeah, August 22nd, we have a little bit better of a song by the Supremes.
Oh, yeah, I like this one.
It's a great song. You can't not like this. If you don't like this, you're an asshole. And I want you to turn off our podcast
immediately. No, stop. Some people might not like it. Maybe it brings back bad memory or something.
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, I will erase your memories for you. Just send me your memories in a jar.
You'll erase them.
Initially, the producers argued over who would sing the song, as it had been cut in the same key as Mary Wilson's voice. But since Berry Gordy had assigned the lead singer role to Diana Ross, the producers eventually gave the song to her.
Oh.
She sang it in her usual high register in the recording studio on April 8th. As a result, Ross was told to sing the song in a lower register and begrudgingly complied with Holland Dozier Holland's To the Letter formula, whatever that is.
I don't know what that means.
Mary Wilson and Florence Ballard's vocal contribution was significant in bringing a fresh yet hypnotic sexiness to the overall sound of the song, while remaining true to the backup arrangements that Lamont Dozier had set down.
That's fascinating.
Upon hearing the song's playback, an excited Ross rushed to Gordy's office and told him to come to the studio to listen. Upon hearing playback, a satisfied Gordy nodded, saying to the producers and the group that the song had potential to be a top 10. Yet.
It was. He was right.
He was right.
He was correct.
And I could listen to that all day. And then on Thursday, August 27, 1964, Mary Poppins was released.
Oh, that was a biggie.
Yeah. This was an American musical fantasy film directed by...
I don't know.
Robert Stevenson.
Didn't know that.
Produced by Walt Disney. Songs and composed by the Sherman Brothers.
You got hiccups?
No, Sherman Brothers, Sherman Helmsley, and...
No, Sherman Helmsley was not one of the Sherman Brothers.
He might have been.
You're making some shit up over there.
Anyway, this is based on P.L. Travers' book series, Mary Poppins. And the film, did you know that it combines live action and animation?
I did know that.
Starring Julie Andrews?
I've seen it.
Don't you feel like that throws it off when the cartoons come in? Like it's...
Not when you're a kid and you're watching it.
I'm not a kid.
Well, then that's probably why. Did you see it when you were a kid?
No, I don't think so. I had no interest in this. It was kind of a girl's
movie, maybe.
Well, that's sexist of you. I'm not trying to hold back women and this Me Too movement, but yes, it's a chick flick. Anyway, in her feature film debut is Mary Poppins, who visits a dysfunctional family in London and employs her unique brand of lifestyle to improve the family's dynamic. Julie Andrews stars along Dick Van Dyke, David Tomlinson, and Glynis Johns.
Yep.
The film was shot entirely at the Walt Disney Studios in Burbank, California.
All right.
Home of the Burbank Bulldogs, where Vic Tayback went to school. And they used painted London background scenes. Did you know that?
Yeah, you can kind of tell.
You can?
Yeah.
It doesn't look real.
I feel like it, if I can remember it right.
Do you want to guess how many Academy Awards this received?
Probably three.
Nope, a lot more than that.
Seven?
Nope, higher.
12?
Higher.
20?
Lower.
Let's play this game all night long.
Everyone's going to love this part. Let's just like record this going like 20 minutes and then we'll just keep... 13.
Okay.
Including Best Picture.
Mm. Yeah, I did hear that.
This was a record for any film released by Walt Disney. It won 5. Best Actress for Andrews, Best Film Editing, Best Original Music Score, Best Visual Effects, and Best Original Song for Chim Chim Cheree. Oh, it received 13 Academy Awards nominations, but won 5. Sorry.
I was going to say 13. That's
a lot.
That is a lot.
And the Sherman Brothers claim to have made up the word supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But the writers of a 1949 song called Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious or something unsuccessfully sued Disney.
Oh, did they?
Yeah, Disney lawyers argued both were nonsense words, so you can't...
You can't copyright those.
Yeah, you can't copyright that. But I have found on YouTube the other version, and I'd like to just play it for you to
see
if you think it sounds the same.
Is it supposed to... The song supposed to sound the same?
Just listen.
We like play a little song with the title so long. It takes almost a chorus to sing it. Just one word, but it's really a bird. Take a deep breath. Here goes. Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
That sounds just like it.
Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
Yep.
First you count and breathe till 10, and then you say it over again. It's supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
Yeah, that sounds just like
almost exactly the same. So it's obviously a copy, I think.
But the tune isn't the same.
Yeah, the tune's not the same, but anyway.
The word is.
Disney lawyers argue that they're both nonsense words. Lyricist Robert Sherman had searched for nearly 2 weeks for a catchy phrase that could be Mary Poppins' anthem. He came across the perfect title when his young son Jeff came home from school one day and announced that he had just received a polio vaccine. Thinking that the vaccine had been administered as a shot, Sherman asked, "Did it hurt?" He replied, "No, they gave it to me on a cube of sugar and I swallowed it down." Sherman tried the idea on his brother the following morning. Richard M. Sherman put the phrase to music, and a spoonful of sugar was born.
Oh, all right.
Yeah, there you go. A couple of things.
Spoonful of sugar helps get rid of hiccups. Did you know that?
Spoonful of sugar.
That's the only hiccup cure that works every time.
Yeah. It can't be good for you to
Well, of course it's not. Sugar. Of course it's not.
So just deal with the hiccups, you pricks. Sorry, that wasn't nice. Friday, August 28th, 1964, according to TheGuardian.com, in a room in the Delmonico Hotel at Park Avenue and 59th in New York City, the Beatles encountered Bob Dylan for the first time.
Oh, that's cool.
Bob Dylan offered the Beatles marijuana.
Oh, and they tried it?
Yep, and he was shocked to find out that they weren't regular smokers. So he actually introduced them to marijuana because he thought they were smokers because he misheard the lyric, "I can't hide, I can't hide."
I get high.
Yeah, he thought it was "I get high, I get high." I think I thought it was that too. I thought it was "I get high."
Well, you were wrong too.
No, I was wrong because Bob Dylan was wrong. So then the Beatles immediately got into it's clearly a gateway drug because then they started doing LSD and everything else. They started sucking each other
No,
off.
That's none of that.
Ringo Starr was the first to be offered a smoke. And he was ignorant of dope etiquette. He chugged through that first joint like a stevedore, attacking his first woodbine of the morning and collapsed in a giggling mess.
Oh, boy.
Brian Epstein became so stoned, he could only squeak, "I'm so high, I'm up on the ceiling." Paul McCartney believed he'd attained true mental clarity for the first time in his life and instructed the Beatles roadie and major domo Mal Evans to write down everything he said henceforth. Dylan, meanwhile, lost his cool and began answering the hotel phone by shouting, "This is Beatlemania here!"
Jeez.
Yep. How about that?
That's pretty cool. That's the coolest story.
That's the coolest thing we've ever talked about on this podcast.
Well, we've talked about some pretty cool things.
Not cool things as that. That was cool.
Well, what about the time when we talked about Sammy Davis Jr. shoving jewelry up his ass?
Sammy Davis Jr. did shove a whole bunch of jewelry up his ass.
So, see?
And then they dug up his body and they exhumed the jewelry out of his asshole.
That's right. It's exactly what happened.
Yes, I think that's exactly what happened. It's probably accurate.
Yeah.
I don't know if we cited sources back then. That was like our first episode, yeah. Maybe. And then Tuesday, September 1st, 1964, we are blessed with the Goldwater Rule. Are you familiar with the Goldwater Rule?
I am not, sir.
Well, it's kind of relevant today because it's the informal name given to Section 7 of the American Psychiatric Association's Principles of Medical Ethics, which states that it is unethical for psychiatrists to give a professional opinion about public figures whom they have not examined in person and from whom they have not obtained consent to discuss their mental health in public statements. It's named after former U.S. Senator and 1964 presidential candidate
Barry Goldwater.
Barry Goldwater, who everybody said he was crazy. The issue arose in the 19...
I wonder if people would probably cite that now.
Oh, that's what I'm going to get to here.
Oh, okay.
The issue arose when Fact published the article, The Unconscious of a Conservative, a special issue on the mind of Barry Goldwater. Mm-hmm. The magazine polled psychiatrists about U.S. Senator Barry Goldwater and whether he was fit to be president, and Goldwater sued magazine editor Ralph Ginsberg and managing editor Warren Barrowson, and in Goldwater versus Ginsberg, July of 1969, received damages totaling $75,000, which is $512,000 today. So regarding Donald Trump, in 2016 and 2017, regarding Donald Trump, our batshit crazy current president, who in future podcasts, I'm sure we will be talking about how he's
hopefully incarcerated.
Lunatic bin or somewhere. He's in some kind of, I mean, it's going to go down in history as the most insane person that's ever had this much power.
Yeah.
In 2016 and 2017, a number of psychiatrists and clinical psychologists faced criticism for violating the Goldwater Rule, as they claimed that Donald Trump displayed, quote, an assortment of personality problems, including grandiosity, a lack of empathy, and malignant narcissism.
Mm-hmm.
And that he has a dangerous mental illness, despite having never examined him.
Did they get in trouble for that?
John Gardner, a practicing psychologist and the leader of the group Duty to Warn, stated in April 2017 that, quote, we have an ethical responsibility to warn the public about Donald Trump's dangerous mental illness.
I would say.
The APSAA, American Psychoanalytic Association of America, I guess, a different organization from the APA, sent a letter on June 6, 2017 that highlighted differences between the APA and the APSAA ethical guidelines, stating that the American Psychiatric Association's ethical stance on the Goldwater Rule applies to its members only. So the APSAA does not consider political commentary about its individual members an ethical matter.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so I guess
that's how they got around it. Yeah.
Yep. And then on Saturday, September 5th, 1964, we got another number one song on the Billboard chart by the Animals. Are you familiar with them? Do you know what song it is?
Gosh, no, I can't remember. House of the Rising Sun.
Yes, it's a traditional folk song, sometimes called Rising Sun Blues.
This is a great song.
Tells of a life gone wrong in New Orleans. Many versions urge a sibling of parents and children to avoid the same fate.
So what's the deal?
This
with
is
that?
The most successful commercial version.
Mm-hmm.
Like many classic folk ballads, House of the Rising Sun is of uncertain authorship.
Oh, okay.
They don't know who wrote it.
It's just like an old folk song.
Yeah, musicologists say that it's based on the tradition of broadside ballads. And thematically, it has some resemblances to the 16th century ballad, The Unfortunate Rake.
Huh.
According to Alan Lomax, Rising Sun was used as the name of a bawdy house in two traditional English songs, and it was also a name for English pubs.
All right.
Yeah,
I can
isn't
see
that funny?
Yeah.
We don't know who wrote this.
That's a good song.
It is.
Mm-hmm.
This version's the most famous.
Yes.
And there you go. That's that.
That was pretty cool.
And then Friday, September 11, 1964, during their first American tour, the Beatles refused to play their scheduled concert in Jacksonville this night until the audience was desegregated.
Oh, really?
Yep.
That's awesome.
The concert was originally to have been racially segregated, but the Beatles refused to perform until they received an assurance from the promoter that the audience would be mixed. We never play to segregated audiences, and we aren't going to start now. I'd sooner lose out appearance money, John Lennon said.
God, don't even try to do the accent.
That doesn't sound like a
man. Don't even. Oh, my God.
We never play to segregated audiences.
All right.
We never play to segregated audiences.
No.
I knew John Lennon, I'd be able to do it.
No, you wouldn't.
The group had been due to fly to Jacksonville on the morning of September 9th, 1964, but their aeroplane was diverted to Key West when Hurricane Dora struck. Most of Jacksonville was left without electricity for several days, but because of hurricane damage, 9,000 of the 32,000 ticket holders were unable to get to the venue. They said the hurricane had passed when we flew into Jacksonville, but it was windy as hell and it was dark with heavy black clouds all over. It had cleared a bit, but there were still turbulent winds, and as we were approaching, we could see the devastation. Palm trees falling over and a mess laying everywhere, said George Harrison.
And okay.
That's unrelated to the fact that it was segregated,
yeah.
I guess.
Yeah.
Friday, September 25th, 1964. Sitcom Gomer Pyle USMC premieres.
What?
The sitcom Gomer Pyle USMC.
Is that the same as just Gomer Pyle?
That was the Gomer Pyle show. It was set in a Marine base.
Yes, I remember. I used to watch that.
The word Vietnam was never once mentioned in its five-year run.
Was it supposed to be the Vietnam soldiers?
I guess. It was a spinoff of the Andy Griffith Show, and the pilot episode was aired as the season finale of the fourth season of its parent series on May 18th, 1964.
Did you watch it?
No, I never watched
it. You never watched Gomer Pyle?
No.
Oh, God, I used to love that show when I was little.
Well, you're like 40 years older than me.
No, so that's
I wasn't
true.
Around in the 60s. I wasn't born yet.
Well, I wasn't either, but it was on syndication for years.
The show ran for... No, we had MTV. The show ran for a total of 150 half-hour episodes.
Rubbing it in.
Spanning for five seasons. We had cable.
You did. I know. I had stuck watching Gomer Pyle.
It was in black and white the first season, then color for the remaining.
Starring, I always remember it in black and
who
white.
Who starred in this? Who played Gomer Pyle?
Jim Nabors. Know?
Jim Nabors, the greatest... American artist in history.
That's
Jim
right.
Nabors.
A hell of a singer, too. Remember his albums that he would sell on TV?
Oh, yeah. He also knows how to please the ladies.
I think I've heard that,
sexually.
Too. Sexually. All right.
And then September 26, 1964, we have another number one song.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to take a guess if it is or is not the Beatles?
I'm going to guess that it is.
It is not the Beatles.
Oh.
It's Roy Orbison.
Pretty Woman.
It's actually called Oh, Pretty Woman. Yeah.
Oh.
The lyrics tell the story of a man who sees a pretty woman walking by. He yearns for her and wonders if, as beautiful as she is, she might be lonely like he is.
We know what song says, honey.
At the last minute, she turns back and joins him. This was inspired by Orbison's wife, Claudette.
Oh.
Interrupting a conversation to announce she was going out, when Orbison asked if she had enough cash, his co-writer Bill Dees interjected, "A pretty woman never needs any money." And then did you know that in 1989 the rap group 2 Live Crew recorded a parody of this song?
No.
Using an alternate title, Pretty Woman. This
I
was
bet
on their
awful.
Album As Clean As They Want to Be. 2 Live Crew sampled the distinctive bass line here from the Orbison song, but replaced the original lyrics with talk about a hairy woman and her bald-headed friend and their appeal to the singer as well as...
So it wasn't filthy dirty like all their other stuff was?
I'm sure it was. But Orbison's publisher, Acuff Rose Music, sued 2 Live Crew on the basis that the fair use doctrine did not permit reuse of the copyrighted material for profit.
Did
and
they win?
The case went all the way to the United States Supreme Court, and Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who loves 2 Live Crew, decided it was 2 Live... The court... decided in 2 Live Crew's favor.
Oh, did they?
Greatly expanding the doctrine of fair use and extending the protections to parodies created for profit. It is considered a seminal fair use decision. In fact, this podcast is a parody of a real podcast.
Keep that in mind.
This is a parody of a real podcast. This isn't a real podcast. This is a parody podcast. everyone. A parody podcast. That's why we can play these songs. Because we can. We really can. Because it's a parody. That's why. Yeah. That's right.
That's right.
Yeah. Okay. And then that brings us to October 8th. I understand you have a little story for us.
Yes, I do.
On October 8th.
I am going to tell the story of Lucille and Gordon Cork Miller.
Lucille and Gordon Cork Miller. That's yes. their word? Then Cork Miller is their name?
That was his nickname.
Like Cork?
Like a cork Miller? In a bottle.
So it's not Cork Miller, one word.
No. Miller is their last name.
Oh, Cork Miller. Okay. Gotcha.
So they're married.
Okay, they're a married couple, a sexy married couple.
He's a dentist.
Oh, I know a couple of dentists.
He was very unhappy, though. He wanted to be a doctor.
He's a sad dentist because he wanted to be a real doctor because dentists are fucking frauds.
Now, don't start.
Sorry, dentist. If there's any dentists listening, please tweet us at History for Jerks and just let us know you're listening so we can stop hurting your feelings.
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
And so.
Otherwise, we'll keep on hurting your feelings.
She, though, was having an affair with Arthwell Hayton.
You know what? There's a lot of. It seems like you're picking stories on purpose of just infidelity. Like you're trying to just tell me something. You want to just tell me something? No. You have a confession to make?
No, no.
Okay. She's having an affair with who?
Arthwell Hayton.
Arthwell Hayton, yeah.
And she wanted to marry him.
She wanted to marry Arthwell?
Yes.
But she had to get out of her dead-end marriage with a friggin' dentist who can't even be a real doctor.
Yes, and Hayton was married to somebody else, too.
Oh, so she's got to kill her
so,
first.
So, the other problem
and then where
was...
where did the rapes come in?
The other problem was that Hayton wasn't the least bit interested in marrying her.
Oh, but he was having an affair still.
Or leaving his wife to marry her,
he
yeah.
He wanted to keep it on the side.
That's right.
On the deal.
So,
side chick.
In the latter half of 1964.
Yeah, the latter half?
Yes. Her marriage
October
to Gordon Miller was in its final stages, one way or the other.
Gordon Cork Miller?
They were fighting all the time.
Kind of like us on a podcast?
Right.
Were they recording a podcast?
Yeah, while they were fighting? Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
I think they
like
did.
Us?
I think they did. So, she had...
Were they fighting over what they call their fans, like time heads? And were they fighting because she didn't like birthdays?
Yes.
Okay.
They probably were. She had already filed for divorce.
Oh, okay.
In San Bernardino in July.
San Bernardino. Okay.
But she had told her attorney right after that she and her husband had reconciled.
Oh, what's the attorney's name? You know that?
I do, and it'll come in later.
Oh, it'll come in later. Okay.
Yeah.
I was hoping to say a stupid name and say y'all after it like I do sometimes.
She didn't explain to them why or how they managed to put their differences aside, but it soon became evident that they had reconciled for at least one night.
Really?
Yeah.
They reconciled, huh? And that, like, things got hot and heavy that night?
Yeah.
Like, they made up and bounce chicka bounce?
Yeah.
Really?
And that'll come back later, too.
Do you have any details on that?
That'll come back later, I said.
Oh. Okay.
So, Lucille and Arthwell Hayton had begun their affair in November of 1963.
Okay.
After Lucille had, he according to him, shown her desire to him.
She showed her desire to him?
Yeah, he said, she showed signs she liked to be around me. Mm. I showed no sign. It was unpleasant to me. That was his quote.
Oh, he didn't like her at first.
So over the next 6 months, they did these little clandestine rendezvous around
clandestine
Southern California.
Rendezvous.
But that's the name of my then she started hotel. Pressuring him. He was a socially prominent attorney.
Okay, he's a big deal.
And she started pressuring him to leave his wife. And his wife was in chronic ill health at the time.
Poor lady. She's sick.
Yep.
And he's calling clandestine.
Pulling a Newt Gingrich.
Newt Gingrich did that?
Yeah, his wife had cancer. And he cheated on her while he was indicting Clinton.
Yeah, while he was trying to get... Yeah. It was like, me thinks thou dost protest too much. Like you grill somebody else for doing something that you feel bad about
doing
yourself. While his wife was dying, I thought that was the other guy. The Democrat guy did that, too.
He did it, too.
What was his name?
John Edwards.
John Edwards, yep. Yeah.
So anyway, he not only then tells her that he has no intention of leaving Elaine, his wife.
Yeah, he can't leave Elaine. She's sick, bro.
He decides he's going to stop seeing Lucille.
Oh, no more clandestine rendezvous for you.
On April 24th, 1964...
April 24th?
April 24th. Did I give you the wrong date? What date did I give you?
You gave me April 4th.
No, April 24th, honey.
You wrote April 4th.
Oh, are you sure you didn't look at it wrong?
I can pull out that.
No, don't worry about it.
Well, let's just say it was April 4th.
Yeah, nobody's going to care.
Who cares? Well, how about we'll just say this. Oh, April 24th? Well, that was 20 days after. three high school friends in Hoboken, New Jersey, Tony Conza, Peter DiCarlo, and Angelo Baldassare, opened the first Blimpy Submarine Sandwich restaurant. And also...
Oh, did it? Was it that old?
Yeah. Also, 20 days after David Cross was born, an American stand-up comedian was born in Atlanta.
Oh, okay. So... He was sailing on his boat near Catalina Island.
Oh, the Catalina wine.
When his wife was found dead in their home.
Oh, wait. He was on a boat when she was found dead?
Arthwell Hayden, yeah.
Arthwell Hayden was on a boat? Yeah, I'm on a boat!
According to investigators, Lucille Miller was the last person to see her alive.
Uh-oh. Lucille Miller was the one he had an affair with.
That's right.
A clandestine rendezvous.
Elaine was found face down in her bed, her face deep in a pillow.
Face deep.
At the time of her death, her death was determined to be of natural causes because she was so sick.
Oh, yeah, she was really sick. So Lucille probably was like, oh, yeah. Wait, but how was Lucille the last known to see her? Can you say that?
Yeah, she was the last known to see her.
Why would you have seen her?
She was over, she was friends with both of them.
Oh.
And she was secretly having an affair with him, but she was over there at their house seeing her.
Oh, wait a minute. This reminds me of the lyrics.
What?
The famous lyrics by Kelly Clarkson. We started off friends.
All right.
It was cool, but it was all pretend. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Since you've been gone.
That's enough.
We're just going to quote Kelly Clarkson.
No, we're not. Okay. So.
Yeah.
Arthwell
Hayden. Arthwell.
He was never suspected of anything in his wife's death.
Okay.
And no one was ever charged with a crime in connection with her death.
And that's it? That's the whole story? Just this happened and that's it? Well, that's pretty anticlimactic.
So with her gone out of the picture,
yeah,
Lucille assumed that Hayden would be more amenable to marriage.
Okay.
But he still told her, get lost. Oh, and then she begins to harass him. It's just like it's like a fatal attraction. Oh,
fatal attraction. She's like, what the hell? Why wouldn't you? But isn't she still married to Cork guy?
Yeah.
Cork Miller?
Yep. In the summer of 1964, she began calling him so frequently that he changed his telephone number.
Oh, my goodness.
And then she found his new number, and she kept calling him.
Oh, yeah, in the 60s, to change your number, you had to go through hell. You had to go traipsing up. You got to get signatures, first of all. You have to meet
the mayor.
You have to talk to the mayor. You have to have coffee with him. You have to meet the mayor's wife. You have to brush the hair of the neighbor's dog.
Okay.
The mayor's neighbor's dog.
So he changes his phone number, and then she finds his new number and keeps calling him.
Oh, and you can't change it again. If you change it once, you can't change it again. You got to do all that stuff again? No way.
One night she called him two times in a row, and he hung up without speaking both times.
Oh, yeah.
She called a third time, and he picked it up. And she says, Arthwell, you better not hang up this phone if you know what's good for you.
Uh-oh, that's a threat.
I've tried to be nice. If you don't see me tonight, I'm going to see you. I'll go into the San Bernardino courthouse, and if you ever thought you were a lawyer before, your reputation will be ruined.
That's because I will tell everyone about our clandestine rendezvous, and they will no longer be clandestine. They will be destined rendezvous?
Yep. So he responded that he would report her to police if she continued to harass him.
Yeah, lady. And we got to keep these rendezvous clandestine.
Look, sonny boy, if you think your reputation will be ruined, your life won't be worth 2 cents.
Oh, 2 cents, not two shits?
So, at this same time, Lucille told her attorney to drop the divorce suit against her husband.
Oh, she said, hey, better stay in this marriage.
And they went to a marriage counselor, and they agreed to have, and then they decided they were going to have another child.
So, do you think
fourth child.
They want to have another kid?
Yeah, now they want to have...
Marriage counselor is like... Okay, so the problem is just that you were having a bunch of clandestine rendezvous. Yeah. That's the main problem. What if instead you just have a baby?
So then in September of 1964...
Oh, and you killed a woman. That's the other thing. Yeah. You killed a woman because you were having clandestine rendezvous and wanted that guy, and he doesn't want you, so why don't you guys have a baby?
Right. So in September of 1964, Cork tells his mother that they had been successful in conceiving a child.
Oh, his mother?
Yep. He says they're going to have another baby.
Okay.
He said Lucille wants one because she feels it'll do much to weld our home and make it a happier one.
Babies always fix any strife.
Less than a month later, Gordon Miller was dead.
Oh, no. Gordon Miller's dead? Cork Miller?
Yeah.
Cork Miller's dead? And the sick wife?
So on October 8th, 1964.
Oh, that's where we're at. You mean the same day that the Republic of China entered the Vietnam War with the first contingent of 15 uniformed army officers led by Lieutenant General Tang Tinguan?
You nailed that name.
The same day that the FBI foiled a plot by the United Clans of America to bomb the Evers Hotel in Philadelphia, Mississippi, where the remaining civil rights workers associated with the Council of Federated Organizations.
Can you imagine if they would have carried that out?
But the agents went to the home of a Klansman and seized a cache of dynamite that he had stockpiled there after having been tipped off by an informer.
Oh my God, that was a crisis averted.
Yes, and this also happened the same day that the Beatles recorded She's a Woman and in Abbey Road. Song. On the same day, drummer Ringo Starr passed his driving test.
Okay, yes.
And the same day C.C. Winans was born.
On October 8th, on a dark road near Montclair, California.
Yeah.
Lucille's story is
yes
that
what happened
she decides they were at home and she Gordon or Cork or whatever you want to call him he had a problem with barbiturates.
Okay.
He was an addict and he was always
Cork was
yeah he was always popping pills and
barbiturates.
He wasn't feeling good and what? So she
hold on what exactly are barbiturates? I remember, like, I took that in health class in, like, middle school.
And they called barbiturates. I think it's a class of drugs, and I...
But are they, like, uppers or downers?
Downers,
they're
I think.
Downers?
Yeah, I think they're downers.
Because barbiturates just sounds appealing to me. I just wanted to take
you
it.
You just want
called
some.
Barbiturates. I don't know what they do or what they are.
Well, he had an issue with them.
Okay.
And so she was going to make him some hot chocolate, but she realized that they didn't...
For the barbiturates?
No, because he wasn't feeling good.
Oh.
And so,
to go with
but then there wasn't any milk left after she made the hot chocolate.
Ah, there's and no milk.
They needed some for the morning for the kids' cereal.
Oh,
so
kids got to have for the
she
cereal.
She was going to go out and get some, but she was scared of the dark. Oh. So she said, will you come
she
with me?
She was scared of the she murdered two. She murdered a woman.
Well, we don't know that for sure.
Oh.
But she says, will you come with me? And he was like, loony, but he said,
no,
okay,
I got too
so
many
he gets
system.
His pillow and his blanket and he goes into the car in the passenger seat and he shuts the door and he kind of like lays back
oh,
in,
must
this,
be downers,
in the
then.
Car. Yeah. Yeah. And so she gets in and she starts driving
in the car with his pillow and his blanket.
Yeah. And so she starts driving
going to get milk and the kids are just left alone?
I guess.
They need milk.
I think one of the kids was older. Like there was a 14-year-old.
Oh.
And so they're driving around and they can't find a store open at this hour.
Oh, not at that hour.
And so.
Not in 1964.
They had this 1963 Volkswagen Beetle.
That was pretty new.
And earlier that evening, the Cork was driving it and he had hit a dog.
Oh,
and it
poor
had
dog.
Messed up the steering linkage in
must
the car.
Have been a big dog.
So. She's driving around, and he's dozing in the front, right front seat.
Yeah.
As she turns the car, she feels something go wrong with the steering mechanism, and she manages to control it for like a quarter mile before she notices flames coming near the back of the car.
Oh, no, because in a Volkswagen, the engine
in
is
the back.
In the back.
That's right. So then the car lurches and hits an embankment.
Lurches and hits an embankment?
Yes.
Both of those things?
So Lucille tells police that she bails out of the car and runs around to the other side to help Gordon, but that side,
Cork?
The door was locked.
Oh, no.
And she couldn't
Cork
get him out.
The door.
And so.
It's on fire.
It's on fire. So then
and
she
his
gets.
His blanket is like really flammable. He sleeps with a super flammable blanket.
Probably back then.
Yeah.
Everything was really flammable
well,
back then.
You only sleep with flammable. But everybody smoked, right? So you would think
yeah.
you'd have.
So she flame gets a rock stuff. Off the ground, a big rock, and she
luckily there was a rock for her
throws
to save
it
him.
Through the rear window.
Oh,
but
and saves
by
it.
This time the car is engulfed in flames, and
oh,
she can't
no.
get him out.
And now he looks like Freddy Krueger.
So she's running down the street, and it's kind of in this desolate place. There's no houses, there's no cars,
there's no milk.
And she gets about a half a mile away and finds a lady who's home.
Oh,
and
thank God for that lady.
She goes in and she makes two phone calls.
You think before she makes the phone call, she says, hey, first of all, do you have any milk?
Yeah. And then if she not, probably did.
For his hot chocolate. Oh, by the way, my husband's on fire, you know, with a blanket.
Well, she
in a Volkswagen.
She was hysterical.
Oh yeah.
And she was saying like, what am I going to do when my kids, when we have the casket and there's nothing inside?
Oh, and what are we going to do for milk tomorrow?
And what are we going to do for milk tomorrow? And so she calls the fire department.
Yeah.
But she's vague. She doesn't give him an address.
Well, because she doesn't know it,
she doesn't really know. And then she calls her lawyer, Harold Lance.
Oh, she calls him right away.
Right away.
That's fishy. You wouldn't even think to call your lawyer.
But they were friends. They were really good friends.
Oh, she's probably looking for the next hookup.
Maybe. So when the police locate where she had called in the fire report,
they were greeted, GPS tracker?
They were greeted by her and her attorney.
Oh, he got there already, huh?
Yes. And so the sheriff's detective, Floyd Jones,
y'all,
later told the press that the coroner reports no injuries were apparently suffered by Dr. Miller before the fire and that he was alive when the fire started. Oh. There was no evidence of any kind of collision or accident.
What?
The investigation found that the car's gas tank was not ruptured, but there was a gas can in the back of the seat of the bug missing its cap.
Uh-oh, she's caught.
And she said that she was driving 35 miles per hour, but the car was in a low gear when it was found.
Yeah, you can't get up to 35 in a low gear, y'all.
Right, and also the right wheel was dug into the ground like it had been spinning in place.
Huh.
And then the gas can had fallen over, but the milk was still upright in the back seat.
So they had gotten the milk. She says she never got to the milk.
Oh, no, she did. She went and she found a store. This was on the way back.
Oh, you missed that.
But the milk was still upright in the back seat, but the gas was spilling all over. And they were like, well, how come the milk wouldn't have spilled over, too?
Okay.
So within days, they arrest Lucille.
Oh, Lucille's finally arrested for her string of murders.
And the police, they thought her motives were the affair. And then there was also a $140,000 double indemnity insurance policy on Gordon's life.
How much?
$140,000.
Double indemnity.
Double indemnity is like if you have an accident. If you die by accident, you get like a big another chunk of money.
Okay.
So,
whoops, hold on. Sorry.
What's going on?
Sorry, hold on. I can't. Hold on.
What are you doing?
Sorry, it was an accident.
Turn that shit off.
I'm trying. Sorry.
All right. So, the rest was a fairly open and shut case.
Turn that shit off.
Except for by the time Lucille went to trial in December 1964, she was visibly pregnant.
She was, because she had just conceived. Like, it's weird that she wanted to kill him when they decided to have the baby.
Well, I know. One of the biggest witnesses at the trial was a woman named Peggy Fisk. She was an undercover officer in the department. And because Lucille's lawyer, Harold Lance, had apparently posted somebody at the jail to ensure that authorities wouldn't question Lucille.
Really?
So what they did was they sent Peggy Fisk in to pose as an inmate. And they put her in there with Lucille for a couple days to see if she could get her to say anything.
Confess or say something, yeah.
But she didn't end up hearing anything incriminating. She said that that Lucille had said she did claim she didn't love her husband, but that she said she had respected him.
Yeah, that's weird.
But she never confessed to doing it
Not even in court?
She said she wanted to, when she was released, she wanted to take the insurance money and get her children and move to Europe.
Really?
Is what she wanted to do. So although the pregnancy might have helped her spare her from the death penalty, because that's what the prosecutors were trying to go after.
Yep.
They didn't have much trouble convicting her of first-degree murder.
They did or didn't?
They did. They convicted her.
They did on what?
Yeah.
When?
She was subsequently sentenced to life in prison. She was granted the privilege of delivering her baby in a hospital outside prison walls.
Oh.
But then the 1960s, she got paroled. Life in prison didn't last that long.
Right.
And in 1971, she was released. She moved to Los Angeles area with her children. In 1973, she was arrested for stealing a $7 blouse.
Okay.
She was ordered to seek psychiatric help while her parole was continued.
Hey, I killed some fucking dudes. This is nothing.
That's right. She died on November 4th, 1986.
Wait, are you telling me she died on November 4th, 1986?
Oh, now this is where the music should have come in.
No, no way she died the same day as the greatest episode of any sitcom of all time, season 3, episode 5 of Who's the Boss?
What is this?
Samantha, that's a hickey.
The hickey. Who's the Boss? The greatest episode of any show ever.
God.
Tony Danza finds a hickey on Samantha on the same day that this woman dies.
I can't believe
that she dies the same day as the hickey episode.
I can't believe you.
Samantha.
And so
that's
a
hickey.
That was the story of the murder of Cork Miller by Lucille Miller. And I got a lot of this for.
Yeah, tell us where you got
the
it.
The Malefactors Register. Okay. And it was author Mark Gribben. But
it's
also
a newspaper or is it a book?
It is a website.
What's a website?
But then I also read.
You read some things.
I read a essay. Oh, shoot. I can't remember the name of it. Because I didn't write any of it down. I was just, after just I read it, it came
gave
off
you some
my
context.
Head. Yes.
But this is not your original work.
Right. Correct.
You're not a journalist.
This is correct.
A parody podcast. But
so I know it's kind of another boring one-off.
No, it's great. It was actually interesting. I mean, all these stories, I mean.
I don't know if I believe that she did it, though.
Because. All those things with the gasoline and everything? And plus, she died when Tony Danza said, Samantha, that's a hickey.
No, I don't know. Because, I read another article that her daughter, who's now an adult, wrote. Yeah. And
what does this say?
And she just did it from her own perspective of, like, waking up one morning and there was police in the driveway and her mom was in bed and her mom said that her dad had died in an accident and then she was real upset and then neighbors or friends of the family came over and took the kids and how then she had to go stay with these friends of the family she didn't like and
what
stuff like that.
What is that?
But
you have doubt.
I don't know the way she described how her mother was. It didn't. It seemed like she was grieving for him a little bit.
It doesn't. Just because you murdered somebody doesn't mean you didn't grieve for her. I mean, she's fucked up.
But she knew that. But her affair with that guy was over.
It clearly didn't matter. I mean, she was in and out of wanting to break up with him anyway all this time.
I know, but she was pregnant.
Yeah, I don't.
I don't know. When you're pregnant, you wouldn't want to kill the father.
What if there's another dude? Maybe there was another guy she was trying to pressure like that first guy.
I don't know. I mean, since she went away for it, I hope she did do it.
Well, we'll never know.
But after I
read. Unless you see her in hell, that's the only time you'll know.
Yeah, I guess you're right, honey.
Samantha, that's a hickey.
All right.
Samantha? That's a hickey.
It's not that funny.
Well, it's...
I guess because I've heard you say that.
No, it hits home for my family because my family all do a Tony Danza impressions at every Thanksgiving and Christmas.
That's true.
And we say, Mona, Samantha, that's a hickey. Angela.
Now, what did
Jonathan,
you say about Mona?
Get back on that bus. Mona, get my wiener out of your mouth.
That's not what you said.
What did he say?
I don't remember. It was something about your cock, though.
Something about my cock, yeah. Anyway, but that, we leave you with Tony Danza saying that's a
Samantha,
hickey.
Samantha, that's a hickey.
And that's going to be every episode from now on. It's going to be that's a hickey episode.
No, it's not.
No, but this was good. We're done. We'll pick up in the middle of October, next episode.
Why not? It's our podcast.
Nobody can tell us
what
to do.
Nobody can tell us whether to do it one way or the other.
You can't tell us what to do, new listeners and old listeners. We have a new listener from Toledo. She found us on Instagram and asked us when we get to the 1800s if we'll cover the Hatfields and the McCoys.
At this rate, we will be probably 70 years old
It'll be like in the year 2030.
Yeah.
But we will do it for sure.
Yes.
And I was going to find her name on here, but I barely know how to use Instagram.
Because you're an old Gen Xer.
It wasn't on that one. It was a couple posts.
I wonder how many Gen Xers know how to use Instagram.
Okay, Melissa K, 1452, shout out. She said, hey, guys, I'm one of your fans from Toledo, Ohio. Love your podcast, but I was wondering if you guys ever get to the 1800s. Could you guys talk about the family feud between the Hatfields and McCoys? And I said, of course we will. And thanks for listening. But she said, we're awesome. And she said, LOL, I'm caught up. Now I have to wait for you guys to put out a new podcast every time. But I wonder why she cares about the Hatfields and McCoys. I wonder if she's got, like, I have a paper due here in college.
Can you hurry up and do that? Depend on our idiotic.
So I can just listen to you guys talk about it.
Our idiot research.
Yeah, hopefully you won't have that paper. Hopefully that paper's not due until 2036.
Yeah.
Because at the rate we're going, it's taking us.
It's going to be quite
some time.
We've
been in 1964 for like 8 episodes, it seems like.
I know. Our son is like, you're still on 1964?
I know, he's making fun of us. Anyway, Melissa K, 1452, from Toledo. She likes crochet and sleeping and working. Thank
Don't
you for listening.
Cyberstalk, oh, no, for Christ's sake.
Well, I just clicked on everything. Thank you for listening. Melissa, I already closed it, so I forgot what number she was, 14-something.
Yeah.
Anyway, thanks for listening. We appreciate you, and shout out to you, and tell all your friends. Make them listen. Like,
yeah.
It's legal to force somebody,
like,
to listen
to
a podcast.
Put toothpicks in their ears, like in Clockwork Orange, and make them listen. Like,
I don't think you need – I don't think toothpicks help – your ears stay open anyway.
They don't?
No, they don't have eyelids.
Oh.
No. My wife, ignore my wife. She's insane. She's insane completely.
Isn't that how that scene went in there?
No, that was their eyeballs.
Oh, that was their eyeballs. Open, yeah,
Clockwork Orange. Anyway, thanks for listening. Matt Truman's awesome.
Yes.
We love you all.
Buy his
I'm
stuff.
In love with all of you.
It's
one time
to get out of here, Chuck
Berry. I Frenched Matt Truman. Time we got here, Chuck Berry. He's in a bathroom. American Timelines, History for Jerks. Subscribe, rate, and review. Come on, we're at 29 Apple reviews. We need one more to get 30. That'd be a big deal. And as soon as we get 30,
and
we get...
And the 30th person wins a prize.
Yeah, we
tell
will
them
send,
about that, honey.
Oh, yeah. If you become... If you're the 30th person that leaves a review on iTunes...
Yeah.
Or Apple Podcast now, I guess, I will send you an empty...
A pube.
No, not a pube.
One pube.
Well, a pube will be probably...
In the envelope. That's usually what happens
when
everything,
you send
mail.
Everything I send anywhere accidentally has a couple of pubes in it. Yeah. I'm a hairy guy. we will send you an empty bottle of whatever I drank last while recording
with
the podcast.
A pube in it.
Like this time, and there'll be a pube in the package, I'm sure. There's always a pube on everything I touch. But right now I'm drinking a Great Lakes Brewing Company, Great Lakes IPA. Boom.
With a pube.
It's based in Cleveland. It's got a pube on it. Like, the bottle's got a pube hanging off.
Gross.
So you could get this bottle sent to you with a pube. I don't know who pube it is. We got a lot of people's pube here. Anyway, thanks for listening. Peace. See you next time.
Bye. One more time, I said we're so tired of hearing about the 60s. Well, make me shut my mouth.
American Timelines is a member of the Queen City Podcast Network, powered by Ortho Carolina. Find out more at queencitypodcastnetwork.com.
A history for jerks.
Samantha, that's a hickey.
Samantha. That's a hickey. Samantha, 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 that's a hickey. That's a hickey. That's a hickey. That's a hickey.